Welcome to another episode of the Mental Fight Podcast. On this episode, I got a chance to talk to Jessica, and we got a chance to really connect on a few different things, like the Air Force. I actually was in JROTC, and it was really cool to hear about her experiences there. And we talked a lot about work-life balance and sacrifices that we made for the sport and making sure that we find a way to stay balanced with the things that we're striving to do. So I hope that you enjoy this episode and stay tuned.
Storm's coming.
Storm's coming.
There's a fucking storm coming, Dad!
Storm's coming.
Storm's coming.
I am doing good, girl. How are you?
Good. It's really nice to finally talk to you, right? I know that I've messaged you a little while ago, and I was like, I really wanted to come find my way out to Albuquerque to come visit and train. It's still on my list. Still on my list.
It's different. Yeah. You're in Houston, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, this elevation.
Oh, elevation there is okay.
You'll love it, though.
I did that. I've been wanting to like kind of find me an RV and just kind of travel around and train and stuff. And so maybe one day I can bring that to life.
Yeah.
But what's been going on with you? What's new? Tell me a little bit about like you and how did MMA come about? I've only seen you like your things that you post, and I've seen a variety of different things from you. So I'm very interested to hear about you as a person and like how MMA shows up in your life.
Girl, I have a lot going on. Let's start from, I was active duty military. I used to be in the Air Force, and then I went to Air National Guard. And so I've been in total like 11, 12 years. And, where MMA comes into play is I didn't grow up watching MMA. I'm still kind of new to it. I've only been training like 5 years, and that's when I started watching it. So it's not like, oh, I wanted to be an MMA fighter when I grew up or anything. But I do have a athletic background. Like I've been running track since I was 4 years old. And then I did bodybuilding and yeah, I've always was into competition and yeah. Outside of that, girl, I got school, I got work, and trying to be an athlete on top of that, it's just a lot.
Wow, that is a lot. And I literally everything that you said, I've connected to too. So I'm like, damn, yeah. I've been doing a lot too.
Yes.
Particularly the Air Force, that's interesting. I did JROTC. JROTC for 4 years in high school.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, and they were recruiting me hard, and I didn't want to go into the service though.
Oh yes.
What was that like for you? Like, what pulled you into the Air Force?
I don't have anybody that's really in my family that was in the military. I think my grandfather, but that was way before I was born. Honestly, I didn't get a track scholarship, and so my goal was to. The Air Force, they have a program where you can like be on the, I guess, like you can be an athlete on their team and like train for the Olympics as a job and stuff. So that was my goal, but I got in and it totally went the opposite direction. So my experience is bittersweet. The benefits are good. I didn't have the greatest experience because that was my first job. I don't take too well being yelled to at the time. And yeah, just the mindset and yeah, it was a lot. And I deployed 3 times. And outside of that, yeah, it's a blessing. Like looking in hindsight, it was a blessing to be in the military.
I hear you say that. And because I always kind of wonder what that would have been like too. Mm-hmm. Cause I too, they were definitely coaching me. Hey, we have a track team. Cause I ran track. I was like, no, I want to do sports and everything, you know?
Yes.
What events did you do in track?
I did the 2, the 4 and the 4x1, 4x4. And then when I was really small, I did 100, but you know, middle school and high school, you know, you get distracted with boys and being a teenager. And so they was like, put 100, 400. Lower.
Oh, man. The 400 was brutal.
Girl, yeah.
But you was fast, huh?
Okay. I was too distracted.
Yeah. So the sports and getting into the Air Force, and then after that, now into MMA. You said that it's only 5 years, like as if that's not a short period of time. You've invested a lot of time. Five years is a nice chunk of time. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. That's true. I actually, when I got, I was still kind of in, I was in the Air National Guard. I was doing bodybuilding. Mm-hmm. And then I used to train at Jackson Wink. I just switched gyms like a few weeks ago, but I was training at Jackson Wink and I went in to Elite Ortho to get like my back worked on. I was like, what is this place? Am I lost? And I saw a cage for the first time. And then I saw people hitting mitts. I thought that was MMA hitting mitts. I said, I could be a pro at this. And then when I started hitting mitts, and then when I learned that, I got to learn jiu-jitsu. And wrestling. It's a difference between boxing, kickboxing, Muay Thai. What? And judo. What? Mm-hmm. Like, what did I get myself into?
Mm-hmm. It all came crashing at you. It's a lot.
A lot.
It's a lot.
It's easier said than done. Yeah.
Definitely. But it sounds like you definitely have taking the time to really like pour into it and invest. From what I see, you look good. I was like, dang, when your fight, when I saw that you had your fight, I was like, all right, let's go.
It's been a struggle. I don't know if you had this issue, but it's been a struggle like for 3-4 years trying to get a fight. But that was a blessing in disguise too, because I really wasn't ready when I was trying to fight. But being, you know, African-American and being looking intimidating, or, you know, or they know the name of your gym. A lot of people like to pull out of fights and stuff. So it's, especially on the amateur level, you're a pro, right? You're a pro. But the amateur level, you know, they pull out like it's nobody's business.
Oh, that hits my heart really, really strong, because I have some theories, because I'm sitting here like, yeah, it shouldn't take that. It shouldn't be that difficult to get matchups, you know, I feel like. There's more women and more women coming into the sport. So I'm like, where are they at, though?
Right.
So I can only imagine, like, you know, having those matchups and people seeing that you train at Jason Winks and, like, you know, they get real in their head and people are trying to pad the records anyway. So...
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And at the time, so I was fresh transitioning from bodybuilding. So I was really like super muscular. And so I had to take all those pictures down because they think I look like that now. I'm like, nah, far from it. But back then I'm like, that's not me. So I took all those pictures down. Like, you really don't even see pictures of me competing unless you actually Google me, but like none of that stuff. So now I just post selfies or stuff. But they know she's not training. This will be an easy fight, you know?
she just want to look like she fight,
right? Exactly.
Not you over trying to find strategic ways to get fighting.
That's how you do it. I said, I'll just post my Pilates video, they'll think I'm not training. That's how you do it.
That is definitely a hard thing, especially you would understand, like going from track and having, you're competing every week and then you have that competitive spirit. So you just wanted to like get into it. And then with MMA, it's like you're waiting for, you know, it's like conception. It's immaculate. Like, you know what I mean? Like, it's not as easy as it is getting another person to like agree. And especially when you have certain characteristics about yourself that may, you know, not everyone's wanting those kind of fights.
Right. And it's tough because, you know, a lot of people, this is their life. And in an amateur level, a lot of people, they don't have jobs. They quit. I quit my job. You know, I work for the government. I work as a contractor. I would quit. Like, I would work every so often. I would quit my job, not realizing like, yo, like, this is not, it's not a consistent path. Like, you're still an amateur. You're not even making money. So I would like take server jobs. I would take like cleaning jobs. I would do so much stuff. And girl, I had to learn like a balance, like go get a job.
Yeah. Yes. Oh my gosh. That's a really great pool to jump into. So this next round, let's talk about that. Cause it sounds like you've made many sacrifices to pour into fighting, and kind of getting to the point where you do have to find balance. Mm-hmm. So this next round, we're going to talk a little bit about that. Round round two. Let's get into it. Mm-hmm. You said that you had to, you've quit your job. You've mm-hmm. taken server jobs to pour into this lifestyle of fighting. Tell me a little mm-hmm. bit more about that.
And let me tell you, the jobs that I quit, it wasn't like basic jobs, little good jobs, like for the government and stuff, six-figure jobs, high-paying jobs, just to try to be a fighter. And so my employers, they would look at me like, you're quitting to do what? And so I would quit that job to be a server at one of the little Mexican restaurants here. Or yeah, I would clean, when I would travel to train, I went out to Cali, I went out to Florida, you know, went to different gyms. I would take a cleaning job, cleaning out, what they call vacation rentals and anything, because I was like, I want to do this. I want to make a living. I thought like it was just a clear path. And I'm like, no, it's not. Mm-hmm. When I was in bodybuilding, I had quit my job before too, thinking that bodybuilding was going to make me money. And let me tell you, I got my car repoed. Okay. This is real life. And I want to be able to tell people this because it affects your life, you know, because then it affects your credit score. You can't get, you know, into a home, you can't get an apartment, you can't get a credit card, you can't get all that stuff. I've been there, been through all of that. And by the grace of God, I was able to, you know, get back my job plus more and, you know, a luxury car and all that stuff. I'm in a good place now, but looking at that sacrifice, it's just got to be smarter about it. If I can tell anybody else coming up, like, they have to be really smart about it. You know, if they can balance a job realistically and train, that would be ideal.
Yeah. We all know they don't pay teachers a lot of money, but I was teaching and I, 2019, my coworkers, they were all like, oh, you're gonna, like, they were very like supportive of like chasing my dream and everything. Cause mm-hmm. I definitely want my job and my career to mm-hmm. go, you know, step off on that ledge to chase fighting, you know. And I did have a plan, right? And I was totally okay with, like, because I used to serve too. I used to be in the mm-hmm. industry. You know, it's a great way to make money and have flexibility. Yeah. So I was like, if I have to do that, then I'll do that. And I, like, saved up money to, like, make this work and make it happen. Because I'm like, all right, as an athlete, you know that there's so much time and energy that goes into that. And then, like, MMA... Yeah. Like you mentioned, there's so many disciplines. There's so much. It's like, I need to be training, like, you know, a full 8-hour shift almost, you know.
Literally.
So I'm like, all right, well, I really want to pour into this and making that, jumping out there to train in California and everything. My money went fast, so fast. And then, COVID happened. And I was like, oh, man. So, although I like definitely felt like I got a lot of time to train and develop my skills and really hone in and focus on that, that time of sitting still with COVID really put me in a position where I'm like, okay, I can no longer coast anymore. And as much as I want to pour 100% into what I'm doing, like, this, the math ain't mathing, as they say.
Right.
I still have bills, you know, and the whole like credit and everything. I feel that too, because it's like you're taking these sacrifices to not be able to afford all these other things. And they're still asking for their money while you're like, but no, I'm just trying to chase my dream. Mm-hmm. And like, they don't care.
They don't care.
And so definitely that kind of, for me, I feel like I had to like dig myself back out of mm-hmm. The hole that I've dug myself into, like in the financial and professional world. And so that's why, like, moving here to Houston, I was like, okay, I need to get an actual job within my career. I need to create, I need to have stability, mm-hmm. Because all of those things are also impacting my health, like my mental health too. Cause yes. I'm stressing about like having a roof over my head. Mm-hmm. How can I really show up to the gym and be able to put my body on the line to do all these things.
Right.
So everything you said about like trying to find that balance between, like, you know, you have still have to be able to take care of yourself, you know. Right. Unless you had that lifestyle to where someone was funding you to be able to do that, then go for it. But if you're, you know, fending for yourself, like, we still have to find that balance when it comes to chasing things that do not have a financial payout in the beginning.
Right.
Middle. So, you know.
Yeah, and even what they said, it's like Stipe Miocic, He still like works his job as a firefighter. A lot of people still in the UFC have to work. Like you see different stories about like different fighters. They had like 40 cents or however much in their account, and they needed to win that fight to have money and stuff. So even at that high level, they're still, a lot of them are still struggling. So yeah, we just got to be so smart about this. So.
Yeah, definitely. And I've definitely heard that part about Stipe and and working, like not having money in your account. It's like, in a way, it's like you hear those stories and you're like, oh man, they really love to fight. But then I also look at it like, I can only imagine like the amount of stress that this person is under, or pressure that they have going into this fight, you know, because it's their livelihood, you know? But for me, like one of the things that I've gotten from fighting was like this kind of being able to see where I am mentally and the amount of effort and energy I have and what kind of things in my life pour into me in a good way and what kind of things deplete me. I don't think that I would want to go into a fight with the pressure of like, man, like I need this to happen. Like there's a level of like you have this motivation to like really want to do well, but it's like if your life is on the line, it's like for me, sports and for me to perform my best, I feel like I want to be happy and free and clear, and I to have heaviness and stress on it just feels like in a way at some point it can get in the way and hinder me, you know.
So true. That is so true. And that's one thing I'm kind of learning like now, to not be in a rush to always get to the next place, but enjoy the process. Enjoy learning and growing and evolving as a, my coach told me, don't just say you're a fighter, say you're a mixed martial artist. You're still growing, you're learning, you know, you're a mixed martial artist. And I was like, that's a good perspective to look at it. And so instead of trying to, oh, I got to hurry up and turn pro, I got to do that and third, like, learn to have fun with it, enjoy the process and grow. And everything else is going to come when it's time, you know?
Definitely. When you have like kind of like that goal oriented mindset, which a lot, I feel like a lot of athletes do have, we get really caught up in so much of our identity being set on like that win, that finish line piece. And when we get to that moment and you did all this work and if it doesn't go your way, then how valuable do you feel, you know, versus every day I'm collecting my coins and into my worth of like, hey, I just got this much better today. I'm grateful for these things. I feel good about what I'm doing. I'm happy. And even if I get to that moment where things doesn't go my way, I still have all of these collections of memories of things that I recognize that, hey, I have gained a lot more than what I feel like I've lost that day, you know? And so it leaves me feeling still a little bit full. It still sucks, but.
Right.
You know, you gotta find a way to enjoy each day, right?
So true. And that kind of reminds me of like waiting all these years to get a fight. And then when I finally got my first fight, I was like, even though I hated waiting and I was tired of, you know, that whole process, like I was glad I did because I actually felt ready. But I had a big incident happen right before my fight. But dang, I'm trying not to cry. My father passed like right before my fight. And he was, I'm sorry. He was my biggest motivator to fight. The last conversation I ever had was him, was telling him I got this fight. And literally hours later, he had a random heart attack and he passed away. And he said, he was going to look for flights to come. And so I got that fight and I felt like it was kind of a symbol in a sense, because finally it happened. And then I debated on whether I was going to take it or not, because like my father is my best friend. I'm a daddy's girl. And my fight was in 4 weeks. It was kind of short notice. But I was like, I put everything I had into that fight. And by the grace of God, I won. And, you know, and I was like, this was my first fight right when my dad passed that he wanted to see, you know.
Yeah.
So mental health since then, it's been sometimes a struggle trying to find that motivation to continue to train because he was always my biggest cheerleader. You know, if I didn't feel like coming to practice, Jesse, go, come on, champ, just get a few more fights. Like, you got this, champ. And I would call him before every practice or after practice. I did distance sparring. Oh, I got this girl. Mm-hmm. You know, and to not have that anymore, it's tough. It's very tough. So just trying to find that motivation to continue to get back out there and to continue training is hard, you know?
Yeah, it definitely is. Well, I appreciate you being so vulnerable and sharing that. Sorry that you had to experience that grief and losing people who are cheerleaders who are so close to us is always difficult. And it sounds like he was heavily tied into your motivation in the sport. Yeah. So it's totally understandable that the feelings that you have around, like, maybe not, you know, getting back into the gym and getting back on it the way that you had, you know, originally, like that motivation that you had before.
Right.
These are always moments where we can definitely find time to reflect and definitely take the time that you need to take care of yourself, mm-hmm. you know, to recultivate, like, redefine whatever it is that you need to do within that process. And think about what's next for you, you know?
Right, exactly. So we're definitely going to see. Definitely. I just, last week was my first week back sparring in a few months. So it's like bittersweet feelings. And then, you know, at a new gym and stuff. So, you know, slowly but surely, you know, getting back out there, you know, hopefully I plan to be active in, you know, May, June. So we'll see as well.
Yeah. I'm always a strong believer in timing, right? Mm-hmm. You don't have to force it. Take the time that you need. And when opportunities and when things are right, it'll work out right on time, right?
Yeah.
As they say. Yeah.
So true. So true.
Mm-hmm. So this next round, I really want to kind of get into the quote that you shared with me. And I hear a little bit about what it means to you. As when we think about fighting, like that last round, when say if the battle is close, this time where you got to go out there and really, you know, show your heart and put it all out there. So this last round, I really want to take a little deeper dive into the quote and what it means to you. Round three, let's talk about those seasons, right? To everything there is a season, a time for every purpose under heaven. Tell me about that quote. Why did you select it and what does it mean to you?
To everything there's a season, meaning where you are at this moment is in a sense where you're meant to be. You know, mm-hmm. for myself, that's a scripture, and I am a believer. I'm a follower of Christ, and so I stand big on just trusting and having faith that everything will work out when it's time. And so that's why I learned during the years that I couldn't get a fight to just enjoy the process. And if it's meant for me to fight, I'm going to get a fight. If it's meant for me to go pro, I'm going to go pro. If it's meant, whatever opportunity is meant for me, it's not going to miss me. It is going to be there. All I have to do is, you know, stand on faith, do what I need to do on my part. And it's all going to work out, you know?
Yeah. Some things are already written.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
So when you think, so in this season, as where are you at in this season? And do you have any hopes of what your next season would look like?
That's a good question. In this season, I am finding my motivation again. I'm willing to evolve as a mixed martial artist, not as a fighter, do the things that I was fearful of doing. And just stepping out and whatever's meant to be is going to be. So, you know, like I said, I'm at a new gym that I love so far. You know, sparring last week, it felt good. Felt good to be under some new coach, new leadership and direction. And I know I'm going to evolve. The next season, we'll see where that leads. I'm honestly, I just want to take things, you know, day by day, because I don't know, you know, yeah. I'm balancing a lot right now, but I do believe this is going to be a good year. I hope to, like I say, be active here in May, June, do some jiu-jitsu competitions, and Lord's will, turn pro and really get it cracking.
Yeah.
But, you know, taking it day by day.
Yeah, definitely. Mm-hmm. There's nothing wrong with that. I'm a big advocate for mindfulness. That at some point in time, there's things that, you know, we're not able to wrap our minds around, mm-hmm. or being able to put a date on it to say that this is going to happen then. There's some parts that are flexible and fluid, and right. we just kind of flow with it and go with it, right? What we do on the daily is going to help, like, you know, create the stepping stones to what's to come. Mm-hmm. Sounds like pouring into yourself a little bit, right. like in order to find that motivation.
Right.
I definitely feel you too. I feel like in my little season over here, I definitely went to the gym today, mm-hmm. not like the MMA gym, but just like a regular gym to lift. And like, I was like, I'm here.
Exactly.
Exactly. That's where I'm at. Like, I did something. Because for me, I'm also trying to work on, like, giving myself grace and some compassion.
Yes.
You know?
Yes.
Like, you already work hard. You already do a lot. And sometimes everything doesn't have to be a lot and hard all the time. Mm-hmm. And in those moments where you don't have as much motivation, is because they do. And for, like, other conversations that I've had with the people who I guess would view, like, you know, being an athlete or doing something like this as if you never have, like, moments where you don't want to do it at all. It's not true.
right.
Like, I'm like, I'm thinking this is a bad day today, you know, or, you know, but I'm like, all right, well, let me at least go and, you know, pull my yoga mat out or do something to stretch today, you know, something that, you know, makes me feel good, and
yeah.
not create more, you know, like heavy criticalness of like right. what I didn't do. Right. But, you know, being grace and giving some love, it feels good.
That's why, grace, I love that word. So that's mm-hmm. why I started Pilates with the reformer, because I was so used to, and I'm such a perfectionist. Like, I was at training. Sometimes I train 7 days a week, including like strength and conditioning, or whether it's just basic drilling, and sometimes two and three times a day. I'm like, oh, if I didn't do something, you know, mm-hmm. and I was like, you know what? Let me do something outside of MMA that's just gonna calm me, and that's actually, it's beneficial, honestly, for MMA. But I started it, and it's just a different pace. So I started doing reformer Pilates, and it's been helping with like my flexibility and balance and stuff. And then when I want to go in and spar and do jiu-jitsu and stuff, I'll do it. But I don't have to always be in the gym 2 and 3 times a day, all day, every day. I'm learning to have also a little life outside of it. And I know they say with this sport, you got to give everything. Yes, but you also have to have balance for your mental health. You know, it's just not healthy to just be on go all the time. You need to sit back and relax sometime, or rest sometimes, you know, or what do they say? Do active resting, you know? So yeah, grace.
Yeah, grace, definitely. We got to realize that a part of training is recovery,
mm-hmm.
And taking care of your body too. Like, the sport will definitely beat you down, and
yes.
you have to do the work to restore. Mm-hmm. And with there being so many hours in a day and so many different disciplines, how are you feeding in some time to do some of those restorative things right. as well? It's big. Well, at least for me. And I want to say for the young athletes, hey, it's going to catch up with you.
You know, right. Now. Right. And stretch. Stretch.
Oh, my track coaches, they were like, you guys need to stretch. And we're like, you know, and not ever really stretching. And I get to now, closer to now, where I'm like, I have to stretch before yes. and after, because I'm feeling things that like, my knee is all the triple jumping. And like, oh man, I'm like, I should listen to my coaches. So I'm like, all right, let me spread the awareness. Please stretch and take care of your body.
Exactly. And try Pilates.
Yes. And, you know, I've heard a lot about, I feel like that's something I might try too, because I definitely want to increase my flexibility. And since I, like, when I first started doing yoga, and I was like you said, the perfectionist, I'm like, I'm always really good at what I try to do. And then to put myself in some, like, positions to where I'm like, I can't even, like, hold my weight, or I can't balance. Mm-hmm. I was like, this is maddening, but I can go and lift this heavy weight. And so.
Right. That's how Pilates is. Like, it's like small movement, but you're like, why does this feel so heavy? I felt so out of shape, because Pilates is not just stretching, but you also can build muscle, you know? And I was like, what the world? So I was like, let me keep going. And I saw Kamaru Usman do some reformer Pilates. I was like, that's the secret.
Mm-hmm. We got these hidden gems out here that people ain't being hip to, but like, mm-hmm. there's so much more to preparing our bodies for mm-hmm. different kinds of, like, athletic things. Yeah. And definitely having to find a balance of, you know, giving attention to all those different aspects. So, mm-hmm. exactly. And definitely, and I'm a big advocate for the connection of the mind and mm-hmm. body. Like you said, like, how we feel about our bodies, how we're feeling internally, like, how that impacts our mood and how we feel. Yeah. And so some things that we do could be more beneficial for, like, our mindset, you know. Mm-hmm. And sometimes those things are the slower things.
Yeah.
The things are quiet mm-hmm. and peaceful, where you need to sit down and reflect a little bit and mm-hmm. spend some time there too.
Right. So true.
Well, I am so excited for no matter where your next season goes, mm-hmm. I hope that that season is just filled with you being happy and well, you know, and whatever that looks like for you. Because, mm-hmm. you know, I think that's what's important, you know. Mm-hmm. And I'm going to continue following your journey.
Thank you. And ditto.
And so for anyone else who's watching, where can they find you and tag along for your journey too?
You can find me on Instagram at fitandbodied, FITANDBODIED. Yeah.
Awesome. Well, thanks so much for coming in.
Thanks for having me.
Time with me. We should definitely talk more.
Sure, for sure.